Hey, it's Zara. In previous videos, we introduced neural networks and discussed different basic architectures and their applications. In this video, we will focus on the loss function, which is at the core of building an effective predictive model in neural networks and machine learning more broadly. So what exactly is a loss function, and why is it so important in training a neural network? Loss functions are the mathematical tools through which we measure models' errors. In simple terms, a loss function quantifies the difference between a model's prediction and the true value, or the ground truth. If the prediction is spot on, the loss is low. If the prediction is way off, the loss is high. The neural network's entire learning process is driven by this measure of error. During training, the goal is to minimize the loss function, or in other words, make the predictions as accurately as possible by reducing the error. Optimizing a model means adjusting its parameters, or the weights and biases, to minimize the output of the loss function. This is why you'll also hear the loss function called cost function or error functions. They represent the cost of bad predictions, something we want to drive down to zero if we could. Let's start with regression tasks, where the model predicts a numeric value, like tomorrow's temperature or the price of a house. For these problems, two very common loss functions are mean squared error, or MSE, and mean absolute error, or MAE. Both serve the same purpose. They measure how far off our predictions are from the true values, but they do so in slightly different ways. As the name suggests, MSE is the average of the squared differences between the predicted and the actual values. Mathematically, if our model's predictions are y1 hat, y2 hat, all the way until yn hat, and the true values are y1 to yn, MSE is defined as follows, where n is the number of data points, yi is the true value for the ith example, and yi hat is the predicted value for that example. We square the differences yi minus yi hat squared so that positive and negative errors don't cancel each other out, and also to heavily penalize larger errors. Squaring makes every error positive and emphasizes the larger errors. For example, a mistake of 2 units errors results in 2 squared, which is 4, squared error. But a mistake of 10 results in 10 squared, which is 100, a much larger penalty. This means MSE will punish outlier mistakes harshly. For example, if one prediction is off by 10 while another is off by 1, the larger error contributes 100 to the loss versus 1, dominating the average. MSE is popular in regression in part because it is smooth and differentiable, a nice continuous curve, which makes it easy to use with calculus-based optimization methods. In fact, MSE is generally the default loss function for most regression problems. Mean absolute error, or MAE, is another commonly used loss for regression. Instead of squaring the errors, it takes the absolute value of the error. In formula form, using the same definitions as before, MAE is defined as the sum of the absolute differences between the predicted and the true values, divided by the number of examples. Each error contributes in proportion to its magnitude, or linearly. For instance, an error of 10 contributes 10 to the MAE, instead of 100 as it would with MSE. MAE gives us the average size of the error in the same units as the original data. One key characteristic of MAE is that it treats all errors equally, whether the error is 1 or 10. There is no squaring to amplify the larger errors. As a result, MAE is more robust to outliers than MSE. If our data set has some wild values that are very hard to predict, MAE wouldn't blow up as much as MSE would. This can be an advantage if we care about not letting a few bad points skew our training too much. However, MAE's absolute value is not differentiable at exactly zero error, or the point where the prediction equals the actual. In practice, this is usually handled using some tricks, but I don't want to get too far sidetracked from the point of this video. In many cases, MSE is chosen as the default for regression due to its nice mathematical properties and the fact that it tends to make the math easier for optimization. This graph compares MSE and MAE values for a single prediction error. On the x-axis, we have the prediction error, y minus y hat, and on the y-axis, we have the loss value. The black parabolic line represents MSE, and the red V-shaped line represents MAE. This visually shows how MSE grows the loss much faster for larger errors than MAE does, highlighting how outliers can affect MSE more strongly. Now, what about classification tasks? For example, deciding if an image is of a cat or a dog, or classifying handwritten digits. In classification, the model's output is typically a probability distribution over classes. We don't just get a single number, right or wrong. Instead, we get a set of probabilities, one for each class. And we have a definite correct class for each example. So how do we measure error in this case? The answer is cross-entropy loss, often simply called cross-entropy or logarithmic loss. It is the most popular loss function for classification problems because it is very effective at guiding the model to output high probabilities for the correct class and low probabilities for wrong ones. In plain terms, cross-entropy loss penalizes the model for being confident about the wrong answer, or for being unsure about the right answer. A model gets the lowest loss if it assigns a probability of 1 to the correct class and 0 to all others. If it gives any less confidence to the correct class, or even worse, gives higher probability to an incorrect class, the loss increases. Let's give an example for a single training example. Suppose the true label is a category like dog out of dog, cat, rabbit. We can represent the true label as a one-hot vector t that has 1 for the dog class and 0 for the others. Let the model's predicted probability for class I be yi hat. Usually these are the outputs of a softmax, a function that converts raw scores from neural network into probabilities. The cross-entropy loss for this example can be written as follows. In this summation, all terms are 0 except for the true class, because ti is 0 for the wrong classes, and t correct is 1. So effectively, the loss is the negative logarithm of the predicted probability for the correct class. So what does that mean? If the model predicts y hat correct to be 0.9, or 90% probability for the right class, the loss is the negative log of 0.9, which is a small number, approximately 0.105. And now let's consider a second case. If the model assigns a very low probability to the correct class, so y hat correct to be 0.1. The loss jumps to the negative log of 0.1, which is approximately 2.302, which is much higher. Thus, the model is severely penalized for confidently wrong predictions. This property of the cross-entropy loss pushes the neural network to put as much probability mass on the correct answer as possible. For binary classification, when you have only two classes, the cross-entropy loss simplifies even further. And in practice, we take the average of this loss across all examples in the batch or dataset to get the overall loss. Cross-entropy is differentiable and works seamlessly with gradient-based training, and is well suited to classification because it directly incentivizes correct probability estimates. So we've defined our loss functions, MSE, MAE, and cross-entropy, but how do these functions actually drive the training process of a neural network? The answer lies in an optimization process called gradient descent, which I have discussed in detail in a previous video. combined with backpropagation. In essence, the loss function is the guide that tells the network how well it's doing. And gradient descent is the strategy the neural network uses to improve itself using that guide. You can think of the loss function as a landscape or a hill that the training process wants to get down from. The height of the hill at any point is the value of the loss function, or how big the error is, for the current state of the model's parameters. Gradient descent is like feeling the slope of the landscape and taking steps downhill to find the lowest point, or the minimum loss. The gradient is the vector of partial derivatives of the loss with respect to each parameter. Essentially, it tells us which direction is downhill in the higher dimensional space of the network's weights. By computing the gradient of the loss, we know how to adjust each weight in order to reduce the error a little bit. This is where backpropagation comes in. Backpropagation is the algorithm that efficiently computes these gradients for all the weights in a multi-layer neural network. After the network does a forward pass on some training data and the loss function produces a loss value, or the error, backpropagation works backwards from the output layer to the input, calculating how much each weight contributed to the error. It's essentially the chain rule of calculus applied to the network's composed functions, breaking down the losses derivative layer by layer. The result of backpropagation is the gradient of the loss with respect to every weight and bias in the network. If you'd like me to go into more details about backpropagation in a future video, please let me know in the comments. So to tie this all together, loss functions and gradient descent are two sides of the same coin in neural network training. The loss function defines the objective. It's the thing we want to minimize. Gradient descent, powered by backpropagation, computing the gradients of the loss, is the method we use to do the minimizing. Overall, loss functions are a central pillar of neural network training. They translate to abstract notion of wrongness and error into concrete mathematical form. These loss functions aren't just passive evaluators. They actively drive the learning process. Through gradient descent and backpropagation, the loss function's output determines how the network's weights are updated. By continuously pushing the loss downward, the network becomes better at its task.